Okay, let's start. I'm Parveen Adams. Some of you will know that I've been organizing artist talks at the AA for over a decade now. This term, there are just two talks. There will be Doho Su on the 24th of this month. Same time, same place. And today we have Mark Lewis. I just want to spend, I should think, 2 or 3 minutes only. In a sense, since you're going to see some films, orienting you to what the kind of thing you're going to see. Mark's work with film is centrally concerned with the idea and the experience of duration. A starting point from which we might develop an understanding of duration. I really should have asked all of you to write down a definition of duration before reading this out, but an understanding of duration is William James' account of what he called the specious present. This passage from the Principles of Psychology 1890 is quoted in an essay on Mark Lewis by Christine Ross. So this is William James. In short, the practically cognized present is no knife edge, but a saddleback with a certain breadth of its own on which we sit perched, and from which we look in two directions into time. The unit of composition of our perception of time is a duration with a bow and a stern, as it were, a rearward and a forward-looking end. It is only as part of this duration block that the relation of succession of one end to the other is perceived. We seem to feel the interval of time as a whole, with its two ends embedded in it. Mark's films offer us an experience of duration. The filmic image holds itself durationally. He changes the conditions of our looking, making it closer to that of painting and photography. Mark's filmic image has a temporal span, but it does not allow of quick succession. Do not expect an action film. A warning from Mark himself, I quote, "You have to hold something long enough so that it can reveal something about itself. But all the time, you have to walk the line between revelation and boredom." Mark Lewis is a co-founder and co-director of After All, a publication and research organization based in Central St. Martin's College of Art. I'm not going to go through the things I've got here. He's been and shown so widely and in so many places that I think I really can skip that. So if I can just introduce it. Not at all. It's films.
Thank you, Parveen. And
would you hear me if I just didn't use the mic? Can you hear me?
Please, can you please?
I'll use them. Okay,
sorry, it wasn't an option. Okay. Thank you, Parveen, and thank you to everyone at the AA for inviting me. Thank you for those very nice words as well. It's going to be difficult to live up to them, so apologies in advance. I started out a few preliminary notes. I actually was reminding Parveen that Mark won't remember me, but when I was a student in London, like so many other students, I used to come here and listen to Mark's lectures from time to time. I was much younger. I guess he was much younger too. I think you were talking about Althusser. I think the seminar I went to, and I don't remember much, of course, but I do remember that they were very interesting and stimulating. And we, you know, came, I think I came for a year to your talk. So thank you, Mark, for letting me audit. Must be 30 years ago. Having said that, I started out first as a photographer, working with photography. I did have a sort of a small career, you could say, making photographs. I was very influenced first by my teacher at the Polytechnic of Central London, was Victor Bergen, and then later on when I Came across the work of Jeff Wall. I shifted my attention, my Oedipal gaze from one master to another. The problem was for me is that I instinctively knew, I think, or maybe this is all ex post facto, that although I was sort of okay, I wasn't ever going to be good enough. And I was in exhibitions with people who were always better than me. And that's a rather frustrating thing for an artist to be in a situation where you know that you're never going to be that great. I still feel that today, but then it was decisive that I had to think about something else to make my own. And I then started a few years of playing around, sculpture, three-dimensional, installation, drawing, anything I could sort of try out to see if I could be better at, including improving my linguistic skills. Eventually, by accident, I made a film. I made a film because a very good friend of mine, Laura Mulvey, suggested that an idea I had around a public art project I was working on would make a good film. And on the basis of that suggestion, I went out and made a film with her. I really enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun. And so I decided to make another one, and then another one, and then another one, and then eventually I realized I was making films, and then I stopped doing the other things. But when I started making films, I did what most other artists of that particular period, of my contemporaries, I was making films about the cinema, and the first half dozen films I made were sort of, I guess in the language of the time, were deconstructions of the cinematic apparatus or something like that. I remember Raymond Ballour once saying in a lecture that, you know, that the cinema is a successful installation. It kind of works, we know it, we understand it. There's nothing hidden about its apparatus or its mechanisms. And I was thinking, if that's true, why are we always deconstructing it over and over again? And I realized that those days were over. And then I had a conversation with an artist friend of mine, and he suggested to me, I was expressing this frustration of working on films that were about cinema, and I was not really interested in it. I was just doing it by default. And he said, well, why don't you just go back to basics and see what the thing is itself? And instead of trying to make something about something else, try to see what the thing itself you're working with is. In those days, I was working with actual film. And I thought, well, that's interesting. And I decided to make a series of films, which preoccupied me for the next 3 or 4 years, where each film would only be as long as one roll of film, one roll of 35 millimeter film, which could either be 4 minutes or 10 minutes. And so I started out, I thought 10 minutes was too long because I was showing in a gallery and I was getting fed up with artists that were doing, including myself, that were doing opuses in the gallery without really good seating and without really good sound system, without good projectors. And we were like supposed to sit there for an hour and a half and watch a movie in a place that wasn't very comfortable and that wasn't really conducive. And at the same time, I really wanted my films to be adequate to those spaces. In other words, to be equivalent to something that those spaces proposed, a kind of subjectivity, a kind of way of looking that was ambulatory, that was repetitive, that was, in the end, and most of all, that privileged the viewer over anything else, so the viewer could be in command of his or her conditions of viewing. That eventually leads to the elimination of sound. But let me just start by the very last film I made with sound, more or less. I made some other films with sound, but I'm not going to talk about those. And it's also the first film I made that obeys this law, that it starts at the beginning of the roll and it ends at the end of the roll. So it sets up a kind of several rules in order to see what happens.
The extra is a thoroughly overlooked phenomenon in the film. If we examine the cinema for its inventions, its real inventions, the ones that are created there and nowhere else, well, then the extra is surely one of the most important. Yet, as far as I know, there is scarcely a word written about it anywhere. The uniqueness of the extra lies in the fact that it is both there and not there. No other story art is able to create this effect so precisely, so contradictorily. Think of the novel. A scene is described. A central character is standing on a street corner thinking about something important. All around her are people walking, shopping, eating, holding hands. I could write this, and that's about as precise as I can get without giving characterization to these background people. But in film, each one of these extras in the background has a real presence on the screen. Some are fat, some are tall, others look a little bit like people you might know. Only film could have the extra both there and not there. Generic, invisible, standing in for a background reality, yet absolutely individual. Extras fill the space, they make it seem real. They carry on imaginary conversations which are never recorded. Their lips flap, but they make no noise that might interfere with the synced sound recording of the actors. And sometimes, if you look closely, extras can forget that they are not really meant to be there. They might look at the star of the film, or even straight to camera. This happens a lot, and you don't usually notice it unless you become obsessed by extra action. And if you do, then you can see nothing else. I was an extra once. Maybe you saw me in a 1980s film called Head Office. I was a background MBA on graduation day at Harvard. And along with the star of the movie, I had to throw my mortar hat up in the air and mouth an absolutely silent cheer. I got $30 for that. I remember on the set, we were all warned that if we tried to speak to the star of our film, then we would be instantly dismissed. Let's face it, extras are the silent proletariat of the film set. Their job is to be quiet and in the background of history. There are, in fact, many different types of extras, different genres, and some of them have quite specialized skills. The revolutionary extra, for instance, is always running up and down, backwards and forwards. On the contrary is the queuing extra, who stands in line patiently for take after take after take. And the riding extra, an important presence in westerns, where cowboys on horses ride across the screen to animate the landscape behind the action. And the dancing extra, whether in period dramas or in disco films, able to take the floor with or without an extra partner. And in Empire films, there are, of course, ethnic extras who have to be able to die in the millions as they are slaughtered by the English, Americans, or French. The drunken brawling extra creates diversions in the bar or in the street. If a movie must go on a bus, then we have the traveling extra. If there is danger, then it's always useful to have the terrified extra. And then for all those street scenes, you can never have enough ambulatory extras, the ones who walk in front of, alongside of, or even behind the actors at a perfectly regulated pace. The dead extra demands a skill all unto itself. Slightly more marginal is the soft porn extra, who must simulate erotic writhing at the drop of a hat. I love all these extras. I love the way they talk and pretend to talk. I love the way they eat plastic food in the background of restaurant shots and look at things and smile, pointing to companions. I love the way they stoop down to tie their shoelaces, the way they smoke cigars, how they look at them, holding them up for inspection as they exhale, or the way they stop for disasters and gasp in horror, their hands placed protectively over their mouths at other extras pretending to be dead. Everything extras do is compelling. So I want to recognize these people in the background. I want to put them in the spotlight, make them important. I want to make a film only with extras. The film will be called Extra Extra, and in it I will stage a number of big budget-type movie scenes, eliminate all the main parts, all the dialogue scenes between actors, everything to do with plot and characterization, but I'll keep all the extras and choreograph their action as if the actors were still there. I want to shoot this film, of course, in CinemaScope, because when it comes to extras, widescreen means literally more of them. This is the moment when you begin to see extras, to see masses of them, writ large across the screen. So you see how exciting a project like this could be. And I was thinking you might be able to help, so thanks a lot.
Strangely, I was at Liverpool Street Station today for the first time in about 15 years. Totally coincidentally. I broke my shoulder recently, so now for the first time in my life, I'm using the tube. I just use that as the, we don't need it anymore because there's no more sound. No, that's it. And I meant to say, please, because there's no sound in any of the films, feel free to ask questions as we go along. You don't have to wait to the end. I'm happy to take questions to go on. Anyway, I noticed that Liverpool Street Station, it's more or less the same, except there's a lot more shops and the sign is still there, but of course no one looks at it anymore. Everyone's looking down in their hands. And I even noticed in the film for the first time, there's actually a young woman looking at an A to Z book, you know. When was the last time you saw anyone looking at an A to Z book? It's like, interesting. Anyway, so that was the last film I made with sound. It's the first film I made using this, these new set of rules that there can be no edit, that the film starts at the beginning of the roll, ends at the end of the roll. And at the same time, as you probably noticed, there's a zoom lens that's automated. And it goes from its close-up telephoto to the widest focal length over the course of the 4 minutes. And it's programmed to do that. So in a way, it sort of reveals materially something which is quite unique to the filmic cinematic experience, and that is the operation of a zoom lens, where focal length is changed through temporarily. So in other words, it changes the compression
the relationship between the foreground and the background of the image is changed, but it changes in real time rather than in fixed time, like in a photograph or in a painting. So this, you could argue if you want, that the zoom lens is one of the few unique inventions of the cinematic apparatus. And I'll explain why I think there are very few inventions. Lights, please. And because my films are silent, I'm going to talk a little bit over them myself. So you have to always make sure this is on, because often when it's exhibited, people complain that it's not working. This is a film called Algonquin Park, Early March, which is probably of little interest to you, but Algonquin Park in Ontario, Canada, is a sort of imaginary heart of Canadian art history, where people like Tom Thompson, if you know, lived and died and painted. But I thought I would like to remake that film that I made, The Pitch at Liverpool Street, and have exactly the same shot, but this time no sound, because I had this impression that no matter how slightly funny and witty my script was, that in a way it distracted from the opticality, what was actually happening in the image. So this is the film where the same lens, the same duration, the same piece of film, 35 millimeter film, and produced, if you like, a kind of the same shot, but somewhat different. And this begins my decision that sound, in a way, is antithetical to the experience of the moving image, because it is, in many ways, too ideological. It overdetermines everything you're seeing. It's very powerful and strong, and it's full of ideas. And often those ideas are, because of their coded and emotional affect, are often not only are they outside the origin of the image itself, but they are so powerful that the image has to succumb to it. And we all have that experience of watching a really, really terrible film. Probably we have that experience more often than we wish. And suddenly we find ourselves bawling our eyes out over something in the film which you're totally indifferent to. You couldn't give a damn that this young man has died because the film is so wretched. But then you wonder, why are you crying? And then, of course, it's the music. You know, the music has piqued your imagination, or it's certainly inspired your tear ducts. And so it seems to me that the experience of looking at an image, one should strip away as much as possible this kind of ideological overdetermination, and leave the viewer free to look at the work and to imagine that he or she is the author of that work. And in order to be the author of that work, of course, they need to be able to have conversation, not only conversation with others, but an internal conversation, a kind of dialogue, an interior dialogue, which is, I think, essential to the work of art. Which isn't to say that cinema isn't art, but it's just to say that that experience that is particular to, comes, you know, through painting and photography, is a particular kind of subjectivity that most museums were built to house, whereas theaters and the like were built for sound. This makes me sound very, you know, like an old guy, but I don't think so. I think it's a rule that can be broken. It's just that I don't break it very often. It's okay, I got it. Good. See, because when film was invented, quote unquote, it wasn't really invented, but when the Lumiere brothers initially set up their little projector in Paris and showed those wonderful less than 1 minute, 48, 50 second films, that they basically showed, that basically just depicted the world. And in many ways, you could say that those, of the 1,500 films that they made through their various crews, you could say that they they just continued a kind of tradition of depiction that, of course, is the sort of quintessence of art, is the idea of how to show the world, how to show what it is to be contemporary. The painters, photographers after that, and now filmmakers, were trying to show other people what it meant to be alive now and what it meant to see things happening in a particular way that we could describe as being contemporary. And you could say that at that particular moment when the Lumiere brothers began this projection, of course, these films were silent. There was no sound. They were not theatrical. There were a few Lumiere Brothers films were staged and theatrical. I mean, many of them were staged, but they were, most of the staging was to replicate real life, which is a lot like my staging in my films. You could imagine that film could have just continued in that way, and we would never have had any cinema in the way we know it. No Hollywood, no British Film Institute. We could have just be today with millions of short little films about the world. There's no reason, ontological reason, why film had to join sound and had to join Aristotelian drama and become a kind of three-act drama and et cetera, et cetera. That was a choice. And in a way, when film emerges at the end of the 19th century, it emerges at this film projection, it emerges at a moment of, you know, deep ontological inquiry about what a work of art can be. And as you obviously we all know, is that at this very moment in painting and increasingly in photography, we have a kind of retreat from heroic depiction and a kind of erasure or confusion between figure and between foreground and surface, between surface and background, between background and heroes. And increasingly, modernism is beginning to focus on the quotidian, you know, what George Perec called the banal, the everyday, whatever, and abandoning these kind of big subjects in order to try and understand what life was like or what the world is like. And of course, representationally, painting in particular was becoming very, very different from, in a different direction to what cinema was going. And you could say that film had a choice at that point. It could either try to become a kind of total Gemeinschaftskunstwerk, a kind of totalizing art that incorporated everything and become a big dramatic form that, and totalizing form, or it could content itself with the depiction of the everyday, if you like. And the depiction of the everyday is the tradition that I'm interested in. And it reminds me of this, I don't know if you've read Sylvia and Bruno, Concluded by Lewis Carroll. I don't know if you know this story, and this towards the end of the book there, it's called The Man in the Moon. You know, the alien asks the narrator, you know, what's the largest, for your maps, what's the largest, what is it called, gradient or ratio that you use for the depiction of the world? And the host goes, well, I think, you know, we do 1 inch to a mile. And then the alien goes, 1 inch to a mile, is that all? And he goes, yeah, well, what do you do? And he says, well, we went from 1 inch to a mile, then we went to 1 yard to a mile, then we went to 6 yards to a mile, then we went to 50 yards to 1 mile. And then we had the most radical idea of all. We decided to make it 1 mile to 1 mile, our map. And so the host goes, did you ever use this map? He goes, no, we were not unable to use it because the farmers complained that if we laid it out over the planet, there'd be no light and all their crops would die. So he goes, so what did you do? He said, well, but then we discovered that we could use the Earth itself as its own map, and that works really well. So I kind of think that there's a kind of allegory there of cinema that, you know, the cinema itself tries to go down the history of cinema and special effects, tries to go down the mile-to-mile route, whereas the Lumieres and all the artists that work with the image, the depiction of a day, have decided to stay with the actual Earth itself rather than the totalizing. I think the allegory is there somewhere, even if I stumbled in the last minute there. Okay, next film is called North Circular. This is an early film too. It's again, it's a single shot. Let's make sure it's running. Yes, a lot of these films, because nothing happens, you have to check that they're actually on. This is where I used to live in Hampstead. This is near Hampstead. This is Brent Cross. This building is, I mean, it's a beautiful but modest modern building from the 60s, now gone. And I used to see it all the time when I went to the airport, or I cycled by it, and it was rapidly becoming more and more deteriorating rapidly. And but I often used to notice that there were young people playing in the building, doing low-level vandalism or just having fun. And I thought that I could make a film there. And so I had a 4-minute film, and I knew where the film had to end, because it had to be a single continuous shot. So that's why the start has such a long hold, because the beginning of the film is determined by the fact that it has to be 4 minutes away from the end. So the film has to wait until a certain point when the camera can take off to get to the wind, well, giving away the plot.
So I'll let it
reveal its own story. So, two things to say about that. One is that ex post facto, I now consider this film to be a love story between two mechanical forms, between the moving film going through this 35mm projector, a piece of magic, if you like, when it was first revealed in the late 19th century. Or was, at least apocryphally, was considered to be. I mean, of course, we don't really believe those stories about people ducking and getting scared, but they make good storytelling. So let's assume that there's some semblance of truth to the idea that people felt they were watching magic. And Spinning Top, which, of course, is a earlier mechanical form of very much source of magic to young children in days before electronic devices, about how something can stay upright without not falling over through centrifugal force, and made particularly or given unbelievably beautiful form by a very famous painting, in a very famous painting by Chardin, that some of you may know. And that painting by Chardin of the young boy Godfrey, whose name I've now forgotten, but looking at the spinning top, is such an important work for me. Chardin is such an important artist for me. Chardin, I think it's a bit of a cliche to say that Chardin was cinematic avant la lettre, but I think it's also true, not only in his understanding of the everyday and in genre, but also in the way in which he conjures up the way duration and temporality can be such extraordinary enigmas. And when you look at that painting by Chardin, you cannot help but feel that the top will eventually fall over. But right now, it isn't. And that's a kind of beautiful moment, you know. It isn't falling over yet, but it soon will. It's sort of, I don't know how to put that on a sliding scale between sort of Baudelaire's idea of the evanescent, the present as a kind of permanent evanescence, or Agamben's idea of the not yet and the already being. But something about that painting seems to, without me being very good at any of that sort of philosophy, that painting does seem to suggest that it's kind of understood Baudelaire and Agamben avant la lettre, if that works. There's something else about that film which I hadn't thought of until right now, is that was the introduction for me of the idea that lights, please, that cameras can fly. So I'm now going to show a much more recent film from 2011 called Beirut. It's called Beirut because it's shot in Beirut. And I increasingly am sort of all over the map here, but increasingly over the years, I've become more and more entertained by the idea that the camera and the apparatus and the film and everything about it, now digitally, of course, I'm not shooting film anymore, has a kind of possibility of sentience. In other words, the whole thing of it, from the shooting to the showing, has a kind of uncanny quality which can only be explained according to these objects being unknowable to us, that there is something I call it sentience, but you know, obviously that sounds a bit kind of hairy-fairy, but I try to imagine that the camera and the work itself have their own intelligence, and that they make decisions that are outside of our understanding. And that leads very quickly to the idea that a camera might be able to fly. And if it can fly, then it can determine its own routes, and it can disobey gravity, disobey, just it can just disobey. In effect, my understanding of cinema now is or film or whatever it is that we, since we don't use film anymore, it's always strange to be using this old-fashioned word for a newer technology, is in a way is not really invented with Lumiere, as I was saying before. That in fact, that what the Lumiere show us is a secondary invention, that the idea of the cinematic is something that's invented in the modern city, that the modern city is the original cinema, with its, shadows, reflections, shining surfaces, vehicles that move you through space in a way that makes you reveals cinematic optical illusions in reverse. Something that really begins again, sorry to have all this avant la lettre stuff, it's always so boring, but it begins really with Borromini. It begins with, you know, the chapel at St. Ivo. In my opinion, that is really the first cinematic apparatus. The idea that as the subject moves through the chapel, he or she animates it, it becomes alive. There's no longer a central focus as there was heretofore in architecture. You're all going to correct me because you're all architects. So apologies in advance. And that this the city builds up this cinematic experience of mobility, of movement, of planes replacing each other as you move, of surface upon surface. And all that film does at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, is in a way replicate that experience. So I would say that the very first people who went to the Lumiere films were not that startled and shocked because they'd already seen it in a reflection in a window. They'd already seen a movie by standing in a curved window in Paris in one of the arcades, and they'd seen a movie happening in the window. So what they were seeing was a second-rate imitation. That got better, obviously. So then this question of sentience subtends with that, because then you say, okay, if this is true, which, you know, again, it's just a kind of, at some level, it's a piece of rhetoric, then how does the camera learn? And if the city is the original cinema, then the camera experience of the city is also a learning experience. It learns how to become itself, and it begins to find things that remind it of itself, as well as remind itself of its ability. Nowadays, of course, it's easy to fly. I fly a lot with cameras that don't even leave my studio, because with projection mapping and 3D work, as you probably know, you can fly anywhere, and it looks like you are flying. But this literally is, there's no special effects in this film. Wait and see. Is it me or is it really hot in here? I was telling Parveen earlier when we were standing outside waiting for the room to be open that when I make films, I really have very few ideas at the beginning. They tend to be generated of really stupid ideas. I don't say that, you know, to be too coy. But I'll tell you in a second what the idea behind here was, and then you'll understand. So she's, at that time, she was a Lebanese under 21 female champion. Quickly, just to give you an idea, the origin of that film. I was invited to Beirut to make a film, and of course I had no idea what to do. And the first night I arrived, you see there's two hotels, you know, and I arrived at the hotel that I had my reservation, and I arrived very late at night, and everybody who I was meeting had gone out for dinner already. And the guy at the front desk said, Mr. Lewis, we're waiting for you. You're sharing a room with someone. And I went, I'm sharing a room? He goes, yes, you're sharing a room. I said, I'm not sharing a room. He goes, yes, you are. It's the last room and you're sharing a room. So he takes me up to the room and there's the guy's things all laid out neatly on his bed, his shoes under the bed and everything. And I'm like, this is not happening. I'm not staying in this room. He said, well, I'm sorry, we have no other rooms. So you either share the room or you go somewhere else. So I said, okay. So I went downstairs in a panic. I went to an internet shop. I looked online, and the hotel opposite, right opposite, had a room. So I booked myself into the hotel opposite, which is the hotel that I starred at, the first hotel we're on top of. And so when it came to, they said, you got to come up. What is your idea? What is your idea? What do you want to do? What's your movie? And the only thing I could think of was moving from one hotel to the other. So the film is just basically me moving from the first hotel to the second hotel. And, you know, and then, of course, it grew from that. The other thing about this film that I didn't realize at the time, sorry, I don't mean to show it again, is that the camera has, not only is it flying, but it's incredibly predatory. And, you know, some people find that it's quite aggressive. And I think it is. And I think there is this kind of, it's like a heat-seeking missile. It's looking for something. I used to say that I thought it was looking for a good composition to, you know, to sort of bastardize Stendhal's famous aphorism, you know, that what is the famous one? I can't remember it now. Art is a, Craig. Instead of a promise of happiness, it's a promise of a composition. You know, that cinema, film is always a promise of composition. It can never compose because it's constantly one frame is destroying the previous frame. It's always in a state of permanent iconoclastic decomposition. Therefore, it is, you could say that every film is just a film in this search of a good composition. And so I thought of that as a sort of heat-seeking thing. But then I realized it's also kind of predatory. And it has a kind of aggressiveness. And I figured in all this, I'm bouncing around here, but I figured in all this stuff that I do about the camera having its own, lights please. I'm gonna show a film that I haven't even finished. I've just shot it. It still has a bit of post work to do on it, but I think it works really well with back to back with Beirut. This is called Things Seen after a short text by Victor Hugo about the barricades. I'll just let it play. I want to see it too. So, gotta get rid of the logo on her wetsuit, just a few other things like that. Parveen reminds me, getting close to the end, there's a film that I shot. I spent quite a lot of time in 2014, 15 in Sao Paulo, which for those of you who have been will know that it is an extraordinary city full of extraordinary architecture and extraordinary urban experience that has rapidly disappeared from most other major cities. And Sao Paulo is the largest city in the Western Hemisphere and probably the largest city in the Southern Hemisphere as well. It has a beautiful 19, you know, center of the city built between the 30s and the 60s, and that is just a cornucopia of architectural amazement. And I'm going to show this one film that I made there called Above and Below the Mini-Con. No, I'm not. Yes, I am. Lights, please.
I believe that's on the poster of the talk.
This Mini-Con is the for those of you don't know it, is a sort of stretch of highway that's built right through the center of the old center, the old Art Deco modernist center. And as you see, it runs right next to the windows of people's apartments. It's an appalling highway that destroys the lives of everybody who lives on it, but every evening after 9 o'clock and every Sunday, it is closed. It's now permanently closed, apparently, I've been told, or about to be permanently closed. And it becomes this kind of urban park in the sky. A bit like the Beltway. Is it the Beltway in New York?
High Line, sorry.
It's the Beltway in Toronto, High Line in New York. It's a bit like the High Line in New York, but without the sort of commercialization of it. It is what it is. I'm sure it's going to become commercialized now that it's closed forever, but it's just a highway without cars. And it becomes a, all the people who live downtown, it becomes their park. There are very few parks in Sao Paulo, at least none in the center almost. And this becomes their park where people go for picnics, where they go cycling, where they go walking, where they go dancing. And the other thing that's amazing about it as you walk along it is that you get this combined with the fact that Sao Paulo has banned all advertising billboards, so there are no advertisements in Sao Paulo, it's one of the few places in the world where you can have what you might want to call a pure sense of architecture. As you walk along this upper level, you don't have any shops at that level, so you just have pure architecture. You don't have any kind of text or pictures or, you know, or commands to buy. You just feel a city in this kind of idealistic, utopian sense of an architectural playground, for good or for bad. And it's quite dizzying, I'd have to say. The first time I arrived from the airport and I was taken there after I dropped my bags, and it was really dizzying. And I knew immediately that I wanted to make a film there.
In the 1930s, Sao Paulo was an Italian city, more than it was a Portuguese city. And you were just as likely to hear, more likely to hear Italian on the streets than Portuguese. This castle, Folly, was built by two Italian brothers. I don't know why. And there's a nice sort of, I don't know, apocryphal perhaps, or real, I don't know, story about how the brothers built that together, and then they fell out with each other, wouldn't talk to each other, and their mother flew over from Rome to try and sort it out, and the next morning after she arrived, all three were found dead. And it's remained a sort of folly ruin ever since. It's now, at least when I was there, homeless people lived in it. There's something about the...
the gymnastics of modern capital, the extraordinary gymnastics of modern capital. Was it Frederick Jameson says, it's more likely now to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. And this road was built in the 70s to get people out of town, downtown, because for the rich, so you get out as quickly as possible because it was full of poor. And all these beautiful apartment buildings that line the building are just filled with poor people. So the poor people, or the poorer people, have been campaigning for years to have this closed and turned into a park, because they don't have a park. Capital decided they wanted to tear it down, because if they could tear it down, then the value of all the apartments would triple and quadruple, and they could evict all the poor and make them into rich, because like every other city in the world, the downtown is now where the rich want to live again. After being scared for 40 years. The vicissitudes, I should have said, of capital are extraordinary. They have a kind of Trumpian dimension. And like all of my films, don't mind me talking over it, but there is a sort of mix of extras that are there and a few that are paid to be there, doing things that hopefully look natural enough in order to help me choreograph the shot. Otherwise, the shot is too random and too, you know, such a complicated shot that requires so many kind of decisions that unless you have something which is fixed, it's very hard to do it. And in fact, this shot was, you know, we shot this all day, like most of my films are shot over and over again. And this is the last shot. It's, you know, near the equator, so the light's going to go out in a few minutes. And this was the last shot. It was the only one that worked. The film was originally supposed to end here, and as I was looking in the viewfinder, I suddenly spotted the couple that are sitting on the what do you call the thing in the middle? The divider, the thing in the middle. And I just suddenly thought, oh, at the last minute I said to the operator, can you just put a slow zoom in now and see what's going on over there?
And so this was like an extra that we hadn't intended. And he's looking at me with, you know, hate in his eyes. You know, why didn't you warn me about this? But he did pretty well. And then they gave us this little gift, which is so beautiful, I think. Gives her that beautiful, you know, when couples have been together for a long time, they don't necessarily kiss madly. I mean, you kind of wish you did still, but often isn't the case. But that little tender nudge, it's so beautiful. It's so kind of like, it says so much about how nice it is sometimes. And that's the gift that the films give because they have a life of their own, and that's kind of what I do, is try to find out what that life is. Thank you. It's his description of the barricade. It's a series of descriptions of the barricades, and in Chauzevu he describes the army or the police coming up to the barricades, and I can't remember the exact words, but a prostitute stands in front of the armed guards, and she lifts up her dress and says, "If you want to shoot at something, shoot at this." And of course, they shoot at her. And then he says, another prostitute, quote, even more beautiful than the first one, lifts up her dress and shows her sex and says, if you want to shoot at something, shoot at this. And lo and behold, the guards obliged and shot her too. This is a film about, quite apart from being about what it is obviously about, in my mind, which may or may not have relevance, it's a film about first encounters. About what happens when Europeans arrive in North America. My friend reminded me that when I described this film, making this film to me, he said, Mark, you remember that most Europeans, when they first arrived in North America, were illiterate and stupid and had no culture. They came to North America because they had no choice. They were starving and had no possibility of anything. So when they arrived, the first people they met were often people in a sophisticated culture who had like a complicated, long history. And one of the ways in which white men in particular, but I guess all men, deal with people who are smarter and more sophisticated than them when they meet them is they shoot them and rape them. So a lot of the first encounters were around a sort of sexual, violent frenzy. And not all of them by any means. Many of them were peaceful. I was thinking of that Chauzevu text about how the woman is the woman's body is the site or the rhetorical figure around which so much of this first encounter or confrontation is staged. And the fact that Hugo even says in that thing, the second prostitute even more beautiful than the first, that it was essential to him that he underlined her physical beauty before he described her demise. So, that, you know, whatever. That's kind of where that comes from.
Yeah, I was really puzzled about the Brent Cross film because I thought you said that it was like a 4-minute thing and you started shooting just to see what would happen.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just kind of zoom in on the top and that wasn't planned? I mean, how do you do that so that the film ends when the top tips over? Or do you, what? I mean...
Well, of course, that young man was there all day spinning tops. No, it's totally staged. Sorry, you want back to the mic?
I beg your pardon. It's okay. It's totally staged.
Right.
But that staging is generated by an experiment, and the experiment was to see how I could get from point A to point B in 4 minutes. And I realized that to get from point A to point B in 4 minutes was just too painfully slow. Therefore, I needed that hold at the beginning. So we had that all worked out. We had the choreography of the camera. And I wanted to put the boys in there because every time I was down there, I saw kids playing. So I thought it was good to have some boys. So we hired three boys to be boys. But I still felt the camera had to end on something, and I wasn't sure what it had to end on. And serendipity was that a bad quotation in a way. I just went to the National Gallery, it was the Royal Academy. The Royal Academy had a Chardin exhibition at that time of his genre paintings. And I was just so struck by the spinning top painting. And I thought, oh, I know what I'll do. I'll end on a spinning top. So it's a kind of direct quotation. And then, of course, the problem was that spinning tops, even then, because that was the days of PlayStation, not yet of iPhone, spinning tops were no longer popular. So it was very hard to find a spinning top that would work. And I thought, in the end, I'd get an electronic spinning top, because that seems contemporary, at least. My daughter and I went shopping. We bought like 50 of them and tried to work it out. Anyway, so it was a quotation. But it wasn't, you know, now I don't care for it as a quotation. Now I just care for it as a kind of pas de deux, you know, between two mechanical objects. I think that's, for me, that's a much more interesting... I think the best quotations, anyway, are as I was trying to hint at before, are done by the picture rather than by the artist. It's not always the case. I mean, you think of Manet's work on Velázquez, of course, it's, you know, these are brilliant, and many artists have worked on other artists' work. But often the most stunning quotations are those that are done by the works rather than by the artists, you know, the works themselves. I mean, pictures are quotational machines, in a sense. Every picture is forced to quotate the history of all picture making. So it's not unusual for a picture to quote another picture without anyone knowing why that happened. So I prefer those kinds of quotations normally.
I do need it. I wanted to ask you about the relationship between your body and the camera. You said I had to get from A to B. In a sense, the camera is early on, it seems to be a direct extension of your body. And then later on, it starts to fly. We understand that it's mediated by a machine. And then in the beach film, which is stunning, we see the footprints of that machine, and it's a different kind of machine. I wonder if you could just expand somewhat on the machine between you and the camera, or whether you're in the machine, or what's going on there.
First of all, thank you
thank you for the compliment. It's a new film, so it's a bit nerve-wracking showing it, and hearing someone say they like it is obviously very nice to hear, so thank you. But I think that's a really complicated question, and I think it's very hard for me to answer, because most of the things that I said to you about that film and every other film our ex post facto readings of them, a sort of retrospective. As I say, I don't really have strong ideas at the beginning of the film. The films kind of teach me, and it sounds a bit coy again, but the films kind of reveal things that I never thought of. And that's what I'm trying to, as I said, I'm trying to understand how, you know, how films are in the world. I think at the once I discovered that if I could make the machine feel more automatic, more, if I could make the camera feel like it wasn't being held by somebody, I felt that the camera had more freedom. And I felt that once it had more freedom, it could do more things. I think that's a kind of really not a very interesting answer to your difficult question, but I think it was as simple as that, just to say that there's a kind of also a contemporary condition that many other people have noted, you know, contemporary writers about the condition of the moving image right now. I did a feature film last year that sort of toured festivals and so on, but it really literally was just a bunch of my films put together in a sort of very vague narrative about the invention of cinema or invention of film. And one of the better reviews said that what they felt was that my camera, which had no gravity, had no limits, could do what it wanted, was a kind of replication of the contemporary condition of surveillance from drones, from cameras on every, you know, in London, on every street corner, there's at least half a dozen cameras that were all being filmed every day. And that, in a way, it sort of replicates that condition of these autonomous cameras that we don't even know if anyone's ever watching. I mean, probably not. I mean, a lot of them are attached to software that examine the footage. Some of them aren't even on, but most of them are examined by software. And the only thing this critic said, I can't remember if it was a man or a woman, but so he or she said, was that at least if, you know, Lewis was in charge, these pernicious surveillance photographs would look beautifully composed. You know, so in a way, I understood what she was saying, or he was saying, is that there was a kind of contemporary quality to my film, which reminds them of a kind of of a cinematic condition which has no author. There is no one controlling it. There's no particular person who's in charge of it. There's no one operating it. It's now operating under its own algorithms, its own softwares, and so on. So in a way, it's not uninteresting to be working in a way that mimics a contemporary condition, I suppose. Another way of answering it, I don't know.
I think in the beach film, for me, the kind of shock is the footprints. There's a truck. And perhaps that's not the way you're because you're coming to it from Victor Hugo, perhaps that's not kind of a particularly important feature for you.
It's a central feature.
It is a central feature,
okay. Totally. Those circles, that film is nothing.
Yes.
Yeah. I stole that, by the way, from another film.
From
Yeah. I stole that from a Brazilian film from 1964 or 63 or something. Yeah, no, not for Guerrero Figueroa. If they did, they copied him. It's a 1960, I can't remember the name, he's 1961, 62 Brazilian film. I'm not going to tell you the story.
Herzog stole it from them.
Herzog stole it from them, yeah. Yeah. So I stole it from him. I hadn't, you know, I didn't steal it from Herzog. I stole it from the source. So I totally stole it. Oh, you mean I should have stolen from Herzog? Okay, I stole from Herzog. Yeah. So, but that was essential. The whole film was based on this idea of the circular. But this spin on my spin, of course, was the fact that my subject or the subject of the film, this young woman, is not intimidated. Because in the Brazilian film, the woman is totally intimidated. She falls to the ground. She's screaming. She's naked. She's crying. She's terrorized. And it's an awful, awful scene. It's really one of the most powerful scenes in cinematic history, I think. If I can remember the name, I would tell you. I have it on my computer, so I can give it to you later if you want. But of course, in my film, the woman is not terrified at all. In fact, she terrifies the camera. We were all terrified by her, actually. She was a jiu-jitsu champion and a figure skating champion, and she was very, very intimidating.
I have a question more like the behind the scene. Mm-hmm. So when I saw the last film in Sao Paulo, I immediately imagined you have like a sketchbook and then you have like frames and with very strong lines, like sometimes like diagonal, you know, sometimes like straight line in the middle. So I wonder when you go to a place, like how does the whole project work? Like you fly around with camera first, you find scenes spontaneously, or you would imagine, or there's like a certain way that you're trying to fit in the film, or like, and what is the order? Like, because for example, in the one in the beach, you kind of go in a circular way, and then whereas Sao Paulo is, you sort of, I wonder if there's like a logic, like, you know, from, you know, zoom out and zoom in and stuff.
Yeah, no, that's good, that's a good question. In Sao Paulo, for instance, it started with a visit, as I told you, straight from the airport, and I immediately realized as I walked on the highway through the city that that this was a unique experience of art. I told you this kind of pure architecture experience that I felt, being elevated in the way that separated you from commerce and so many other things. And I also was really overtaken by the experience that there were two worlds. So there's a world below that was very vibrant and the world above, and that these two worlds were almost acting independently of each other. Nobody was paying any attention to above and nobody's paying attention to down. So I thought, I should have two people that are engaging up and down in order to draw these two levels together. So those are my two actors. It's the man on the phone and the woman who's running from side to side following him, because he's done something, or who knows? I don't know what the story is. So that was. I mean, this came much later. So the idea was how to depict those two spaces at the same time, draw them together, because I noticed that nobody on the different levels knew that the others existed, at least for the course of the film. And then I usually start by practical things, by a lot of photographs. Like I tend to take a lot of photographs of a place. On that particular location, I think I went back, I went to Sao Paulo, I think, 9 times in a year, and I think I went to that location, and the last time I went there, I shot it. So I did 8 visits to it, not only to that location, other locations too where I shot, or 7, because the last one was for the opening. So 7 before I shot. So start to experience it and live it in a way and be part of it and try to understand it. Not that I really do understand it. And then I thought, well, we're aerial. Maybe this is too much detail. Is this too much detail? So then I thought, well, okay, this is an aerial. We're looking down on one level. So I thought, well, maybe we should look even higher. And so then I thought, well, let's have a drone fly over. And I hate drones, but I have used them for shots that I needed it. And luckily it's illegal to fly drones over very busy civilian areas, because if they drop out of the sky, they kill people. So in the end, nobody would fly a drone above. So I went to plan B, which was this extraordinarily huge crane. And which I'm so glad I did, because it's so much more precise and it's so, you know, it's way more choreographed than a drone, which is a little bit more haptic, a bit more all over the place. And then we just laid, you know, 30 meters of track on a diagonal across the road, so that we could go from one side to the other. We could go underneath and on top. And, you know, just basically, I wanted to explore, once we picked on that particular crane, I wanted to explore everything that crane could do. So I then started to choreograph the shot to take advantage of what the crane could do, bearing in mind that I had these two actors. So that's kind of how it developed, and then in the end I shot it like that. But then in the end, almost nothing that I planned happened. You know, all the things I wanted to happen didn't happen, and all the things I didn't want to happen did happen. And in the end, you know, that's what makes, again, what saves the film from the banality of the original idea, is that the film takes over and produces its own form in some way. And then and the great thing about working with lots of people is that you have that, you have a lot of people inputting, you know, I mean, everybody's doing their job, you know, but I'm going to sound a little bit, you know, overexcited, but there's something about the poetry of it, you know, when you have like 40 people working to make a shot like that and everyone doing their own little thing, and at first it just doesn't work and it just collapses and collapses, and it's a complicated shot, right? There's a lot of moves, there's a lot of things that have to happen. Just collapses and collapses and collapses, and I'm standing there looking at my cinematographer saying, it's not going to work, we're fucked. He says, be patient. So we just go on. And then suddenly, it all comes together. And everybody is like a machine. Everyone just kind of greases in, and it's just so beautiful. And someone, along the way, someone's saying, well, I think it could be a bit better if we did this, a bit better. And it just builds up and gets better and better and better and better. And then it works. And I like that way of working, because it sort of helps me out a lot.
In your films, I always get the impression that time and movement are separated. It's like one of those scenes in films where everything stops, but you can still move around and all your movements have no consequence. It's kind of separated from time. Except in the first piece where you confront the camera and talk about extras, and in the last piece of The Encounter, which is the camera has a direct consequence on the character. And I can't help but see those as bookends to the process now, and I'm wondering if you're returning to something or if it represents a new direction in the way you think about time or the camera. I don't know.
I don't know either. but again, it's, you know, like those are good observations and interesting ones. I think another way of, I might have presented that film at the end, sorry, at the, not the end, the beach film. Another way I might have presented that beach film, by the way, that's a lake, not a sea, not an ocean. But it looks like it had to stand in for an ocean because we couldn't get permission to shoot on the ocean. There was too many bylaws. But we shot on Lake Ontario, which sort of on a windy day looks like the ocean. Is that all this talk that I have about the camera having presence and having this kind of blah blah, you know, sentience and so on and so forth, and always going off wherever it wants, but it never really ever confronts its other, which is the, you know, the human. And so I thought, you know, it's about, I should start thinking about how that might happen. And so that another way of me thinking about that film was like, how does the camera interact actually with a subjectivity that actually has its own sentience, its own ambition and its own desires, and not just as a tool for composition. You know, like in the swimming film at Beirut, she's just a compositional device, right? The camera flies all over and finds something that looks good, a swimmer. But in this one, the camera flies, finds something, but the thing it finds, you know, wants to participate in that moment. And so maybe, you know, maybe, yeah, maybe that's, I was getting a bit bored of doing films like the Minicon. You know, because I got lots of them, you know, that, like the one on the highway in Brazil, lots of films that dance around and do things like that. So maybe I was just getting a bit bored.
I have a really quick question.
Hi, Sammy.
Hello. Would you say your camera is masculine or feminine?
Oh, my God. I don't know.
Or is it important?
You know, I don't know if you guys read this guy called Eugene Thacker. He writes about, you know, I guess it's sort of it's sort of contemporary philosophy, and he sort of posits the idea that at base the world is not just unknowable, or there aren't just things hidden about the world, but there's a kind of fundamental unknowables about the world that we don't know anything about, and that's its sense of uncanny, and that's its sense of danger, and that's its sense of peculiarity. And, you know, we're just a kind of momentary dance trying to understand what these things are, and what we don't understand is that we can't understand, that these are outside of our comprehension. And I like to think of the camera as being a little bit like that object that he describes of the planet, of the world, that it is a fundamentally unknowable thing. And that's what produces its uncanny effect, that it, you know, why does it do things that we didn't want it to do, or that we didn't plan for it to do? It did it because we didn't know, and we still don't know what it can do. So I don't think it has a sex. Of course, you know, Laura Mulvey says it is a male, you know, and that it's predatory and that it's aggressive and that it's, you know, and she's right in many respects, but that's, perhaps that's just a way to pretend to understand it. Maybe the real radicality of things is that they can't be understood. And maybe that applies to their sex as well. Is that a cop-out? Why, what do you think, male or female? Male or female?
No, I mean, but it's hard. It's then you kind of have to separate the artist from the work. I guess I would.
I'm a man.
Yeah, exactly. So I see the masculinity in it, but maybe, you know. So it's just difficult to draw that separation. But I see what you mean.
Yeah, I think those are important things, you know, and I'm not trying to duck it. You know, I think, you know, the question of gender and the cultural artifacts that are cultural constructs that go with gender are extraordinarily important and help to determine the way. I mean, we only have to see, you know, that I know this is we're all bored of the United States at the moment, but you could only have to understand that you know, that's how it's working right now, you know, that we can see that masculinization of, or whatever is, you know, is determining almost everything. But, you know, it's like, I remember this quote, I'm sorry, I don't mean to keep name dropping, but I remember this quote from Roland Barthes, I don't know where it comes from. And, you know, I don't even remember what the quote was. But I do, sorry. But I do remember the punchline. So I'm gonna have to make up the quote in order to reveal the punchline. And he's giving a lecture at the Collège de France, and some smart-ass student, this is, I apologize, I didn't mean.
Sammy used to work,
Sammy used to work at my studio, so I know how amazing she is. Mr. Bart, so what you're really saying is that, you know, the sign, I don't know, this is a bit I'm going to make up. What you're really saying is that signs are determinating. And he goes, and his reply, this is the bit I remember, he says, yes, that's correct, as long as you forget all the rest. So that's what I think about the gender thing. It's correct, but there's a remainder, and that remainder is the thing that we don't know.
Okay, can I thank you very much?
Thank you very much for having me.